Teller's faith in the good judgment of American democracy was matched only by his fear of the Russians. He once told a colleague that if he didn't build the super, the Russians would take over the United States and he would be their prisoner.
To imagine that he would be a prisoner of the Russians within the United States if we didn't build a hydrogen bomb tomorrow is an irrational statement. There's no question that those weren't nice people. There's no question that that was a terrible criminal regime. But there is much question that they were the real drivers of the arms race. We were the country, the United States was the country, with one notable exception, and that only briefly, that invented the new weapons that the Soviets then followed on and built themselves.
History turns its most ominous page far out in mid-Pacific, where in the Enemy Talk Atoll, the world's most awesome weapon is readied for detonation.
It took 2 years to build Edward Teller's superbomb. At 10.4 megatons, it was 1,000 times more powerful than the Hiroshima weapon.
Well, the trouble with the super was that not only that it could be made arbitrarily large, but it couldn't be made arbitrarily small. And nobody knew exactly how small you could make it, but it was intrinsically thought to be a weapon that necessarily had to be many megatons. And there was certainly no military use for such a big bomb, and there, in fact, there was very little use for it at all, because the same tonnage in smaller bombs would be more destructive.
Are you satisfied from the radiological standpoint, Commander Manet?
Yes, sir. The situation is ideal since the entire fallout pattern is to the north of the inhabited islands.
Thank you, General.
No one, not even the scientists who had built the bomb, knew what the results of the test would be.
Niner, eight, seven,
who had seen a lot of nuclear tests by 1952, who, when they saw the Mike test, were frightened. It just seemed to keep coming at them as they stood on their ships watching this thing grow and grow until the mushroom cloud was 100 miles across.
With the super, America regained its nuclear preeminence. 9 months later, the Soviet Union successfully tested an H-bomb of its own. Robert Oppenheimer's opposition to the hydrogen bomb was interpreted by government officials as disloyalty to the United States. In hearings held by the Atomic Energy Commission, he was stripped of his security clearance and retired to academic life a broken man. Edward Teller was treated as an outcast by many of his colleagues for testifying against Oppenheimer. But he won the battle of the super. He would go on to advise the government on nuclear issues throughout the Cold War.
Taking to the hills, the rocky cliffs above California's Beverly Hills to visit the first atomic survival house. Only the overhead.
With the world on edge over the threat of nuclear war, Americans invented ways of coping with Armageddon.
Hal Hayes, a bachelor, spent $250,000 on this hideaway where he can sit out any atomic attack in comfort. There's champagne on tap along with a variety of stronger stimulants just in case anyone needs a bracer when the bombs are falling. And a radiation-proof curtain will keep out the uninvited gamma rays.
The weirdness of the time,
indoor swimming pool is provided.
The paranoia of the time, the atmosphere was so tense. I remember more than one time walking on the beach, facing New York, but not being able to see it, but there seemed to be a great stillness suddenly. Birds weren't flying. Something was happening. I felt immediately. Everything was just too quiet. And I looked off to the direction of the city just to see if there might be a mushroom cloud rising.
We bought a house on the Berkeley Hill with a big picture window overlooking the Golden Gate. And Emilio Segrè, Nobel Prize winner in physics, came to visit us. He said to my wife, "Sherwin, you will pay for this view with your life." He was afraid that San Francisco would be bombed with an atomic bomb, and he personally moved out of Berkeley back to Walnut Creek, about 20 miles inland over the hill.
There was a turtle by the name of Bert, and Bert the turtle was very alert.
A government-sponsored campaign taught children what to do in the event of nuclear attack.
He's duck and cover, duck and cover.
He did what we all must learn to do.
You
and you
and you
and you.
Duck and cover.
I think there was probably a deliberate effort on the part of the United States government to play down the destructiveness of nuclear weapons. When children were taught that they could dive into a ditch as if this were a tornado going by, when children were taught that if they hid under their desks, covered their heads with their hands, duck and cover, that somehow that would be enough for them to survive, they were being taught at most the Hiroshima level of destructiveness.
Some of us actually refused to do it, but for some kids, this is when you found out in your peers who was the most afraid, because a lot of kids wouldn't talk about it. It was a subject that they perhaps didn't really want to participate in because it wasn't sports and it wasn't whatever. So those drills were very revealing to the rest of their classmates when we saw who was really the most afraid.
Might not be any grown-ups around when the bomb explodes. Then, you're on your own.
I had this very vivid nightmare of this ball of fire that was sort of out there, and I just sort of walking toward it, you know? And, you know, I would see myself actually engulfed in this thing. And, you know, I remember, you know, jumping up and screaming and, you know, and it was that, and sweating and feeling, you know, that was one of the few nightmares I still remember very dramatically to this day.
This is Times Square, New York, prior to the start of a civil defense drill highlighting Operation Alert. The drill is part of the survival phase of the fourth such test held in this country. Less than 2 minutes after the take cover signal, the streets were cleared. Times Square is deserted.
I wrote a piece for Esquire about the whole madness of the civil defense drills. And I interviewed some general who was in charge of civil defense for New York in case of an atomic attack. And he kept talking to me, you know, in all this jargon. And I said, "Look, just tell me this. Well, what happens if an atom bomb actually hits New York?" And he says, "You mean ground zero?" You know, and I said, "Yeah, what if it hits Manhattan?" He says, "Well," he says, "it's goodbye, New York." So I wrote a piece called "Goodbye, New York."
What would you do if you had the air raid warning system here in Denver sound a warning that a real atomic attack was imminent?
Well, I think just what we're supposed to do, and that is to find our shelters.
I think I'd find the baby, get a chair, sit down and wait. I know nothing else to do.
You don't know where you'd wait?
Inside. I wouldn't go in the cellar. Sit in the living room.
Put your trust in what?
God. Beyond that, I have none other.
Again, the fireball. Now, for dramatic effect, we superimpose it on the skyline of New York. The heart of the metropolis would be instantaneously transformed into an inferno, while shock and heat waves devastated the rest of the city.
You really learned that there could be an absolute atomic disaster in your town. We had a nice house in Huntington Woods, Michigan, and we had a fruit cellar down there. And at my behest, and I'm not sure my wife thought I was in my right mind, but we put bunks down there, and we put sleeping bags down there, and we put extra water down there, and we put canned food down there. And I kept trying to figure out some way to reinforce the ceiling. I don't think I ever figured that out. But the theory was that when we heard the sirens go, we were all going to run down there and go in, and we might have to stay in there for 2 weeks. So we had it stocked up to support us for 2 weeks.
A new housing development near Denver, Colorado, shows the nation's first model homes with built-in fallout shelters. The room is designed with an atomic war in mind. But behind each 8-inch thick reinforced concrete wall, it may prove to be just what the harried housewife is looking for when life with the kids gets too hectic.
You can have as much explosive force as you want in a nuclear world, but you can't necessarily win when you get that much in the world. There is a level beyond which to use the force you have at your hand destroys you as well as your enemy.
I don't want to set the world on fire. I just want to start a flame in your heart.
The United States and the Soviet Union developed the nuclear capability to wipe out one another's major cities many times over. The weapon that was designed to alleviate all fear had become the greatest fear of all.
No other will do.
The question is, was the arms race successful at the scale it extended to? Did we have to build so many? Did we have to put ourselves at such terrible risk? Did we have to nearly bankrupt ourselves? Because it wasn't only the Soviet Union. There's been one reliable estimate based on government numbers that the arms race, if you count the delivery systems as well as the bombs, cost us $4 trillion. And that was the United States' national debt in 1994.
I just want to start a flame in your heart.
Throughout the world, learned to look on the brutal face of communism. Berlin, powder keg of Europe, saw a mass demonstration of indoctrinated young Germans.
For the first time in their history, Americans faced an enemy whose ideas, they believed, were as dangerous as its military power.
Loading of Marshall Plan aid, and across the world in Japan,
communism was public enemy number one.
But far more sinister to Americans was home front communism. Union Square in New York was the backdrop for these scenes of red violence. From their ranks will come the saboteurs, spies, and subversives should World War III be forced upon America.
We know that communism is an organized threat to our way of life. But how far do you feel that we should go, we here in America, in legislating against it?
Well, I think it should be curbed somewhat. I don't know that it should be outlawed completely. I think when it becomes a threat to our democratic way of living here in the United States, that something should definitely be done about it.
Well, I think we should fight communism in every way possible. We can't force it underground, as has been said, any more than it already has.
Tales of invasion by alien creatures, a new genre of science fiction movie, played to America's anxieties about its vulnerability to attack from within.
They're like huge seed pods.
This must be the way that body in my closet was formed.
Miles, where do they come from?
I don't know. If they are seeds or seed pods, they must grow someplace on a plant, probably.
Invasion of the Body Snatchers really struck at a way of communicating the notion that people were the same, they looked the same, but they were different. And, you know, that was a real sense. You understood, it was more about brainwashing. It was more about the notion that which was people were fed at that time, that communism was a drug that sort of took you over and that made you into something else.
Suddenly, while you're asleep, they'll absorb your minds, your memories, and you're reborn into an untroubled world.
Where everyone's the same?
Exactly.
What a world.
There had been communist menaces, so-called red scares before the war. There was one after World War I. But this time, The communist menace was supported by this huge military power, the Soviet Union. And of course, we gave the Soviets far more credit than they deserved as far as their weaponry and their reach was concerned. But it gave us a kind of a Satan figure. And people were very comfortable in the 50s. Everybody wanted to keep what he had. And the communists represented someone who wanted to take that away from you.
What happens when an aggressor seizes power in a democratic country? The Army shows you as part of Exercise Longhorn at Lampasas, Texas.
It was impossible to believe, if one looked at it seriously, that the Russians were all that big, all that powerful, that they could scare us all that much, that we had to go into this fit of paranoia. We didn't see us as the big bad wolf or the big good wolf. We saw ourselves as the little guy, although we were the biggest, roughest, toughest country in the world. And we saw ourselves as essentially defenseless.
In recognizing a communist, physical appearance counts for nothing. If he openly declares himself to be a communist, we take his word for it. If a person consistently reads and advocates...
Since most Americans had no idea what a communist was, government propaganda films provided helpful hints.
More difficult to detect are the undercover workers of communism. They can be discovered only through sharp vigilance over a long period of time.
I remember on the job, I had lots of low-level jobs in art supply houses of one kind or another over those years before I could start making a living. And I dare not bring in, of all papers, the New York Post, which was a liberal paper at the time. It was considered a communist rag by my, not just the bosses, but my fellow workers. And you'd give yourself away if you wore a Stevenson button. You couldn't do that. This is in Democratic New York. Again, that showed you up as a pinko. I mean, the atmosphere was absolutely insane.
Calling the House Un-American Activities Committee to order, Chairman J. Parnell Thomas of New Jersey.
The Hollywood film industry was the first target of anti-communist crusaders.
Stripling, the next witness.
John Howard Lawson.
It's unfortunate and tragic that I have to teach this committee the basic principles of Americanism.
That's not the question.
Are you or have you ever been a member of the Communist Party?
I believe I have the right to be confronted with any evidence which supports this question. I should like to see what you have.
Oh, well, you would.
Yes.
Under pressure, Hollywood caved in. Anyone suspected of having communist ties was blacklisted. Films dramatizing the heroic search for the enemy within hit the screen.
All right, that's swell, but I'm still a comic.
For the time being, yes. We have more surprises for the Reds, but we aren't ready to show our hand.
A wave of anti-communist paranoia swept the country in 1946 when news broke that Igor Guzenko, a cipher clerk at the Soviet embassy in Ottawa, had identified real Russian spies operating throughout North America. Arrests and deportations followed. Ethel Rosenberg, convicted of selling atomic secrets to the Soviet Union, became the first woman in U.S. peacetime history to be executed for espionage.
Yes, there was a certain amount of fear there. I never felt it. The people I lived with never felt it. Nobody where I grew up was looking over his or her shoulder to see if the Red Menace was crawling up through Ebbets Field or something. It wasn't. But there were people who felt it, and I think media particularly, it was the last days before television took over. The media in particular, the Hearst chains and a lot of the sort of right-wing conservative chains of newspapers helped feed the fear.
With the fear of communism running rampant, Americans felt they had to stay vigilant or risk losing the Cold War without a shot being fired.
Danger! Can't you see? We're after you!
The time was ripe for a demagogue, someone who would find communists wherever and whenever he chose to look for them.
You